I want to read from the book of Mark, chapter 10. And I want to bring only 3 points today. And I want you to know I can go on and on this. It's very powerful. I can see layers upon layers. But I want to bring only 3 points. Mark chapter 10 and verse number 46. And they came to Jericho. And as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace. But he cried the more a great deal, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good cheer. Cheer up, man. He calleth thee. And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus. Next word. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, go thy way. Thy faith has made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. I want to bring 3 points. And you might have read this story many times. I've preached on it in crusades. I don't know how many times. But what I'm going to say today are words that I'm hearing for the first time. I want to talk about 3 things. Number 1, identity. Number 2, actions of faith. Number 3, change of positions. Why do I say identity? You know, when you read that, there is a certain kind of strange thing with those names. It's intriguing. Because his name is Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus. Anytime you see the word bar in Aramaic is son. In Hebrew, if you see the word ben, it means son of. So in Aramaic, bar means son of. In Hebrew, ben means, you know, if you hear the word Ben Hail, son of Hail. Ben-Hur, Ben-Judah, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus. That's all. But look at the redundancy in that. It says, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus. Next word, son of Timaeus. Can you imagine? 2 times. Actually, in the Greek, it is exactly how I said it. Son of Timaeus, son of Timaeus. And I wondered, my goodness, does this guy have a name? Son of Timaeus, son of Timaeus. The Lord told me something. You know, there are people that have got different ideas of what that name means. For a Greek man, it means son of uncleanliness. Jewish people say it means son of honor. So look at the difference. And the Chaldeans say it means son of blindness. These are speculations. I don't want to go into that. But what is so powerful? That he does not even have an identity of his own. He's carrying something. The only thing that we know about him is blind. The only thing people know about him is what is wrong with him. There's nothing that people he can talk about himself. Not even a name. If you want to talk about him, he can just say, you know what, I'm blind, I'm a beggar. That's it. That's not a very, you know, kind of impressive biodata. It's not a great profile. But I heard a voice today. And I want to keep it prophetic. People who are carrying things from generations will be set free. And then the Lord told me something. Whatever is your issue being son of someone, today, by calling out, son of David, son of Timaeus is going to come in contact with son of David. When son of Timaeus comes in contact with son of David, doesn't matter what your past was. I heard loudly tonight, doesn't matter where you came from, doesn't matter what kind of a baggage you're carrying, today when you come in contact with the son of David, your life will never be the same again. If you believe that, can I hear a sound of amen in the house of the Lord? Son of Timaeus is coming in contact with the son of David. And when that happens, let me tell you, you'll never be the same again. How many of you can say, my life has been changed, not because of some names connected to me, my ancestor, my father. It's because I came in contact with the son of David. If you believe that, can I get a testimony in the house of the Lord? It was the son of David that changed the son of Timaeus. Number two, action of faith. I'm trying to keep it very, very, you know, restrictive to those prophetic words. Action of faith. Look at this man for a moment. This is not like any other time before. Everything that he did was much more activated, much more what you call hyper, if I could use that word. I'll give you a few examples. When he cried out, the Greek word used for cry out is the loudest cry that you can ever cry. It's not just a whisper. It's the loudest, most clear, you know, cry in a public setting. That's a Greek word. And then, look at all his actions. Then he says, Jesus, son of David. You know what did they tell him? Jesus of Nazareth is going. But he changed that prayer. He didn't say Jesus of Nazareth. He said, Jesus, son of David. You know what it means? You are the Messiah. And in the book of Isaiah, there was a prophetic word. One of the signs of the Messiah, when he comes, he will open blind eyes. So what is he trying to do? He's connecting Jesus to his situation. He's connecting Jesus to his condition. And the Lord told me, today, if you believe, if you need a healing, call him your healer. If you need a deliverance, call him your deliverer. If you need a salvation, call him your savior. If you need a family breakthrough, call him the one who can do all things. Come on. Somebody needs to change their prayer. Today when you pray, you're connecting Jesus to your situation. How many of you believe Jesus can do what you're going through? He can change it around. He can do it. So his prayer was more intent and very direct. And then, you know, they asked him to keep quiet. The Bible says he cried out even more loudly. He is a persistent, relentless guy. He will not take no for an answer. And four, When they came and told him, he is calling you. You know, the Bible says he threw his garment. Don't think he became naked. It means the outer garment which covers his tunic. In those days, somebody who's begging would have an outer garment because that's his blanket in the night. That means that's his livelihood. That's on which he's going to sleep that night. And then, like panhandlers, he will use that garment to collect his money that is dropped into his garment. So this garment represents who he is today and what he will be. Because to sleep that night, he needs that garment. To collect money as a beggar, he needs that. But he just threw it away. You know what he's saying? I believe I don't have to sleep there again. I believe when Jesus calls me, my life will never be the same again. Now let me ask you today, is anybody who can joyfully witness in this house, when Jesus calls you, your life will never be the same again? You don't have to stay in the same place. You don't have to be in the same condition. You don't have to go through the same situation. He can turn things around. Can I get an agreement in the house of the Lord? He will turn your situation around. And finally, look at this man. The Greek words used in that passage, when they told him, cheer up, he's calling you. The Bible, Greek word is, he jumped up. He leaped. So everything that he did that day was hyper. His screaming was loud. His prayer was different. Come on. And then his jumping up was very, very animated. And throwing away his garment is making a stand, determined. And finally, when Jesus came and asked him, what do you want? He said, I need my sight. Very specific. His prayer was specific. His screaming was loud. His jumping was too high, or what do you call it? Too activated, too animated. Everything was determined. You know what? When your time for a move happens, you cannot have half-hearted measures. You cannot be sloppy. You cannot just take this moment as any other moment. If you prayed, you have to pray like you never prayed before. You have to do something like you've never done before. And let me tell you, because this is the moment that's going to change your life forever. How many of you want to say, I believe God has got a plan for my life, and I'm not going to let anybody stop me from entering that plan? Can I get somebody who wants to give the Lord the best? Come on, it cannot be half-hearted. It cannot be just a whisper. It cannot be what people might think about me. I don't care what people think about me. I want my life to enter the destiny that God has called for my life. Can I get a witness in the house of the Lord? This is about your future. Come on. Everything about him was different. I see people are on the verge of their miracle, but still acting like the previous days. They pray like before. They open their mouth like before. They act like before. There is no change that denotes a certain determination on their part. But tonight, I want to see somebody in this place who is determined to see God move. Who is determined to see an anointing on your life. Who is determined to say, I am going to go out of this place as a new person in the name of Jesus. This season is for my family. This season is for my life. And I am going to receive it no matter what. And what is so fascinating, his faith had already reached that point that Jesus didn't have to touch him. Normally, Jesus put mud on somebody's eyes, clay, and said, go wash. In some instance, he laid hand and said, be healed, let the eyes be opened. But in this case, nothing. He simply said, your faith has already made you heal. Your faith has already healed you. I don't even have to pray for you. The Lord gave me a specific word this morning. In the days to come, because of your faith, even before a prayer is uttered, your faith has reached a point where the miracle has already happened. The miracle has already happened. Can I get a witness? This is going to be the next step for somebody's life. This is the next step for somebody's family. The Lord says, I don't even have to lay a hand on you. You have all received your miracle. You have all received your healing. Come on, if I can see somebody who knows what I'm saying, God has only done a miracle in your life already. Hey, Shantalori, I'm going to make a strong statement here. The days are coming that even before somebody pray for you, you are so much energized in your faith that God says, I don't even have to lay hand on you because I see your faith has already healed you. My son, I was about to heal you, but I see that you've already been healed. Your faith has already healed you. That kind of a determined faith is going to rise up from this place. And I'm going to make a declaration of faith. In the days to come, some of the things that you wanted the church to pray for, you will come into a church not to pray, but to give your testimony. Because God has already done a miracle in your life even before somebody prayed for you. How many of you want to walk in that kind of an anointing? Can I get a witness in the house of the Lord? I'm talking about a new generation. Come on. Hallelujah. You can just go back home because God has only done a miracle. Whew. I love that. I'm seeing this in the eyes of faith. In the days to come, somebody will come for healing of cancer. And before the church can pray, their faith has reached a point. You know, they will come forward and say, I came to be prayed over, but excuse me, I've got to change that word. Today, I want to tell you, I came to be prayed over, but I have already received my healing because God has already done it. I don't need prayer. I just need a time to give my testimony. Is anybody who can say that in the days to come, even before somebody prays for you, because of your activated faith, God is going to do a miracle already in your life? Can I get somebody to put your hands together in the name of Jesus? I'm talking about another level of faith. Are you with me? Come on, are you with me? Can I make this an open statement? Somebody just receive it as a prophetic word over your life. In the next few days, even before you pray, just the way you lifted up your voice when you heard Jesus, just the way you addressed him and declared he is your healer, just the way you jumped up, just the way you threw that garment saying, I'm not coming back. The Lord says, even before prayer happens, you're going to receive your miracle in the name. Please listen with every molecule in your being, because this is truly a word of prophecy. You know, the Lord told me, look at where he's sitting. He's sitting. As Jesus is about to enter Jerusalem. So he's not in Jerusalem. He is in Jericho. But truly he's not in Jericho. He's on the threshold. Jesus is sitting just in front of Jerusalem. But he's not in Jerusalem. The place of promise. He's just sitting so close by. But actually he's on the threshold, the brink, the cusp of the next move. And probably he sat there for years because beggars do have their exclusive spot that they have got a certain, you know, authority and right to be there. And this is very powerful. Because the Bible says in the story of the Good Samaritan, a man went from Jerusalem to Jericho. He was mugged. He was beaten up. He was almost killed. The Good Samaritan came. So he's sitting in a place that's a place of danger, darkness, muggers, thieves. But he can see Jerusalem. For some reason, he's not able to enter. But this healing was not just opening his eyes. The next word says, after he got healed, he followed Jesus. Where is he going? The next chapter, Jesus entering Jerusalem through the east gate. The great procession is happening. And blind Bartimaeus is also there in that group. And the Lord told me, some of you, this fasting and prayer, even the fact that you came today, you're entering through a gate into something that is very powerful. Till now, even though you could see Jerusalem, you were stuck in Jericho. You were on the border. And I sense there were people who always sensed that you are on the threshold. You sense that you're right there, but not there. You're almost there, but you're missing something. And today, the Holy Spirit is going to push you into that place. But remember, you're crossing over into something glorious. Why do I think this is important? The moment the word gate came, Jesus entering through the east gate into Jerusalem. And that's a place where he asked for a donkey. He was about to enter Jerusalem, but this time, Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, is also in that group. You know what is so special? This is not just any entrance. This was prophetically spoken by the psalmist David. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. This was prophesied by Zechariah. This was prophesied by Ezekiel, that the prince will come through the east gate. That means this particular moment, which was prophesied over thousands of years ago, which the Messiah is about to fulfill, Bartimaeus is also part of that. I don't know how many of you are understanding what I'm trying to say. This moment, which was eternally planned by God, prophesied over centuries, that the prophets of ancient times were waiting for that moment to happen, that will decide the history of Israel once for all. Let me tell you, that moment, that cusp of that moment, that threshold of that moment, Bartimaeus, who was a son of Timaeus, he's part of that procession. Come on, hallelujah. The Lord tells me to tell you, some of you are going to join the move that God had prophesied over Edmonton, over Canada, over nations. Come on, if you believe that, can you make a sound of joy in the house of the Lord? This is your moment. Oh, can I get a witness? I can sense an anointing on my body right now. Some of you who do not deserve to be part of it, let me tell you, you are a Mr. Nobody. You didn't have a name. But God says you're going to become part of the next move of the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus. Hey, if I had a trumpet, I would have blown the trumpet today, because the announcement of that moment is now. Hallelujah. You are entering the prophetic season of God. Hey. Woo. Yes. Receive it. Young people, older people, receive it. A Mr. Nobody. That sister over there. I've never seen you before, sister. You are entering. Keep praying, everybody. You are entering. Can you imagine a Mr. Nobody? A man who didn't even have a name to his life. He had to be called redundantly son of. A beggar, blind, is now part of the team. That prophets that prophesied over centuries back, the Lord is prophesying over somebody, even though you didn't know that. God is taking you into what He had prophesied over this nation, over this land, over nations of the world. How many of you know what I'm saying? Can you give the Lord a baptized kind of shout in the house of the Lord? You are entering the season of the Lord. Receive it, my people, receive it. Oh, Shandala Rabba Shande. Melinda, others, please receive it. A Mr. No One. You know what the Lord is telling me? This nation is on the cusp of the greatest move of God. The nations of the world, what you saw was the uprising of ISIS. The coming up of gay, legalized situations. But what I'm about to tell you, you are going to see a move that's going to overcome. That's going to overcome the power of darkness. A new move of the Holy Ghost. And the Lord says, you are going to enter with Jesus into that. Hey, if you know what I'm saying, can you lift a Mr. Nobody? A Mr. Nobody. But you are going to be part of the next move of God, which God had prophesied. A move of signs and wonders. A move of miracles. A move of prophecy. A move of healing. The move of the dead coming back to life. Because the Lord is telling me, you know, something that God had planned years ago, centuries ago, which is going to happen across the globe, in the land of Canada, for the sake of your children. The Lord says, a no-name man, a no-brand man, is about to be part of that move of God. If you really believe that, can you put your hands together, give the Lord a praise in the house of the Lord? This healing was not just for your healing. It is to take you through a gate. But those of you standing, remain standing. We'll just finish it now. You know what? When I read that gate, I said to Lord God, I'm hearing the word door. Is there? I can always say gate is door and all that. But I felt that this man was sitting before a door into something, a shut door. So I said, God, is this word connected to a door? The moment I'm asking that, I hear a voice. Psalm 24:7, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lift up, you everlasting doors. The King of Glory shall come in. This man was sitting right in front of that glorious door for 40 years, 50 years. But now the King of Glory, when he's coming in, he's taking this beggar. Sorry. He's taking this blind man, this no-name man with him into that door. And as I was meditating, I'm sitting on the bed and meditating, I'm almost sitting like this. My wife comes to me with a statement which makes no sense. She comes to me and says, did you know, she was hearing a message today, that one of the places in Kerala called Adur, where Tijo has got his very powerful prophetic ministry. She was seeing a life program. She said, you know what Adur means? The Lord told Tijo, Adur means a door. A door. She told me, a door, while I'm thinking about door. I knew the Lord sent my wife into the room not to disturb me, but to confirm that word. A door is being opened. And I want to declare today, some of you are entering the door that God had prophesied. Come on, I want you to just receive it with a praise as how you want it. Come on, receive this prophetic word. Some of you are entering a door that God had planned for this nation, for your future, for your destiny. If you can believe it with shouts of praise, shouting Hosanna, shouting joy, you're entering the door that God had planned for your life. Hey. Let me finish it by saying this. The Lord gave me an assurance. Are you ready to receive this? The door that Jesus entered, Ezekiel prophesied, that door will get shut down, will be closed. Do you know if you go to Israel, there are 8 doors, 8 gates to the city. But the only gate that is shut by the Turks in, I believe, 13th, 14th century was the East Gate. Ezekiel prophesied it. He said, that door on the east shall remain shut until the Prince of Glory shall come back. You know what? If you go to Jerusalem, the Muslims have put all their tombs in front of that gate so that the king cannot come in. They will prevent, they want to prevent the Messiah from coming in. But I want to declare, God is going to shake that place. The King of Glory is coming back to Jerusalem. The first time he came on a donkey, but this time on a white horse. He is coming as a King of Kings and the Lord of Lords through the East Gate into the city of Jerusalem. Hey, 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 hey. Hallelujah. But what the Lord told me is interesting. That gate was not supposed to be shut down. When Jesus entered that gate, it was supposed to remain open. But because of the unbelief and the rejection of the Messiah, Jesus said, I will not come back until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The Jewish people rejected him and the gate got closed down. But what is so fascinating, yesterday night my wife told me something. She said, you know, God gave us the word myrtle tree. The Hebrew meaning of the word myrtle tree, Hadassah, means open door. And that's interesting, but what she told me next was more interesting. It also means, oh, this is exciting. It also means, I don't know what you call it, hinge or stopper. When a door is opened, it won't shut back again. You put a stopper. Right? Is there any other word for that? Door? Stopper. The word myrtle tree means the door that is opened will remain opened. You know what? I'm going to make a statement for the church. From this Sunday onwards, we are opening up a Sunday service for anointing and for the move of the Holy Ghost. I am declaring people that go to other churches, you don't have to leave your church, but they'll come in the afternoon at 3 because the Lord is moving in this place. Hallelujah. every service there's going to be miracles, healing, people being set free by the power of the Holy Ghost. Can I get, it's an open door, open, come on somebody, can I get a celebration as we are? And the Lord specifically told me, you know, when I go for crusades, I go for healing crusades, I've seen people brought in stretchers, crutches, with crutches, blind people, all kinds of sick people. Sometimes I get 25, 30,000 people. And I'm going for a crusade next year in Feb. And you know what? They pray for 1 year before I arrive there. They've got a full chain fasting for 1 year before the meeting happens. No wonder when I step on the platform, miracles happen. The Lord told me, can you treat your Sunday service with that seriousness? I will show that I am the God of Canada as well. I can do it in Edmonton. Come on. Can somebody join the move of God as we are entering a new door? You know what the Lord told me? You know, let there be dedicated people in the week to pray for the service. Maybe you will fast. One person says, you know, Pastor, for the Sunday service, I will fast from morning till evening. And I will pray. Or somebody says, let's have a chain prayer. Somebody will pray on Monday, Tuesday, and on Sunday when we come here, we are expecting the next move of God. So I'm going to pray right now. It's a new door. So I want somebody to join me today. Bertie Myers, he screamed like crazy. He acted like crazy. He's jumping up and leaping up. Leaping up and down. Let me tell you, he's blind, but he can still hear. I don't know what all he knocked down on the way, but he heard a voice. Cheer up. The master is calling you. I thought it was just a call for healing, but it was beyond that. The master is about to enter the most prophetic door. Spoken over. And I sense some of you are going to enter that door that has been prophesied. Anybody in this place who wants to make an action, I'm not going to sit in front of that door and just see what's going to happen beyond that. Today, in the name of Jesus, I'm going to enter the door of glory. Come on. Can somebody join me in the house of the Lord? But today, let your faith rise up. Call Jesus like you never called him before. Declare your faith like you've never declared before. Act as if there's the first time you're doing it, but you know for sure your life will never be the same again. Hallelujah. I was thinking, if that man throws away that garment, what will you do that night when it's so cold? He says, what are you talking about? I don't need this blanket because I'm not going to be here tonight. I'm going with Jesus. I'm going to glory land. I'm entering the prophetic season of God. Through the garment. Lord says, if anybody wants to show with an action, you are no more going to be the old person sitting in the same place forever. You are coming out. Let me tell you, God is taking you into that promised gate, promised door in the name of Jesus. Can you do that? Here you go. To the extent Jesus must look at you and say, you know what? Now I have no need of prayer. You're already healed. Your faith did it for you. Now go. The Lord says, today, bondages are going to fall down. Miracles are going to happen. So next 2 or 3 minutes, would you lift up your voice with faith? Declare something about Jesus. This is not how Bertie Myers declared. The Greek word is as loud as he can. He said, Jesus, Son of David. Jesus! I'm going to make a declaration right now. Some of you were standing, sitting right on the threshold of that mighty season of God for your life. But today, the Lord told me, you're entering through the door. You're coming out of Jericho. You're entering Jerusalem. If you believe that, can you make an action of faith? Action. Lord, as a church, we are entering the prophetic season for this nation, for this country, for our church, Lord, for our families, Lord. We have been waiting and waiting, but today we are entering in the name of Jesus. Hey. So in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, we declare today we are entering what God had planned, prophesied, purposed even before we were born. We are entering into that purpose of God.